And we are back on this Monday, November 5th, 2012 edition. And the interview that we're about to conduct is one of the most damning and shocking things that I've probably ever covered. Because when you look at the information, it's all there hiding in plain view if we have the will to actually look at it and admit what it is to ourselves. I saw a clip a few days ago from Fox News with Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Schaefer, a intelligence officer, Bronze Star winner, the guy that ran Stratus Ivy and other programs who could have killed bin Laden now 11 years ago but was ordered to stand down. I saw him breaking down the facts of what happened in Benghazi, and being a news person, I follow this every day. I knew everything he was saying was very accurate and admitted, and that the president had clearly lied when he said for 5 hours that they didn't know this was an attack and that it was a group of protesters. And now the facts are coming out, and we know they lied. The question is, what did they lie about? Why would they endanger their entire administration to let this Al-Qaeda-affiliated group engage in this long firefight and protracted action and then kill him? And then expanding from that, what were they trying to cover up? So Lieutenant Colonel Schaefer joins us. He's also the best-selling author of a book dealing with his missions in Afghanistan. We'll talk about that because it ties into some of this at the end of the interview. But Colonel, if we can, because on Fox News, obviously you had the host and the other colonel on there with you interjecting their points, but basically agreeing with you. Start from the beginning, flesh this out of what we now know really happened, and then the rest of the story, Colonel Schaefer.
Well, let me begin with the point that I think, as you point out, so much of this, Alec, is hiding in plain sight. And one of the most obvious things, which the mainstream media continues to fail to recognize, is that this was a protracted battle. We're talking about starting in the evening, say between 7 and 8, and lasting until the next morning. Now, one notable thing, just to frame this whole thing, and I think this is where we're going to go with this, from what we were talking about, is that during this entire time, no one knew the ambassador was dead. And this is notable by the fact that one of the things you'd think they'd want to do is find him by the fact you would not want to have a hostage situation similar to the one that hobbled Jimmy Carter during his reelection campaign back in 1980. And think about this. If Ambassador Stevens was taken hostage, every day there would be a reminder of the failed policy. So therefore, you have to wonder, why didn't the recovery of the ambassador take front and center from the moment that he went missing? And it's notable that there's been no mention of that by any outlet, that how they wanted to go after him. So with that said, it's very clear now that within the context of the event of 11 September of this year, of 2012, it was very clear from the moment, I'd say about 4 p.m. after Ambassador Stevens met with his last visitor of the day, which apparently was the Turkish representative. That's notable. Turkey is partnering with us right now in a covert action to help do two things: increasing level of intelligence we're aware of by using the Turkish intelligence assets on the ground in Syria, and by actually working with us to quote-unquote arm the friendly rebels, whoever they are. And I think that's notable by the fact that Ambassador Stevens met with this Turkish representative right before the firefight. The next thing we know, and let me be very clear about this, there was no demonstration. It was quiet, all quiet on the Western Front, if you will, there in Benghazi. Nothing was going on. And over the next few hours, it became very clear, by the admissions of some of the SEALs even, that there were things going on which were peculiar, their own guards taking photographs of their positions. This is a huge clue to the fact that it appears now that Ansar al-Sharia penetrated badly, significantly, the 17th Brigade that was supporting, supposedly, an allied to the CIA and Department of State, an allied militia, which is supposed to be providing essentially some level of support and security outside the embassy. Well, it's very clear now that this group was very badly infiltrated by Ansar al-Sharia, an al-Qaeda affiliate. And so that's where the fun begins, so to speak. You had wave after wave of attacks starting at about 8 p.m. Going until the next morning. The culmination of which was the mortar attack, which ended up killing the two Navy SEALs, Doherty and Woods. So during that entire time, Alex, is what now becomes one of the mystery points. Who did what? When were they notified? And what was supposed to happen once the notification was given? And I think one of the things that's been very clear to me based on my sources is that the president was notified by something called a critical incident report, which is handled through CIA classified channels. That report, I'm told, and it's been verified pretty much by Tom Vietor, the spokesman for the National Security Council, that they did receive notification on a timely basis about the attack. Well, then, if that's the case, then who did what? What was the response? What should have been the response is something that is really done by the terrorism group that the president should have assembled.
Now, let's walk through this, though, because this is really important, expanding on it. I mean, obviously, you've got a bunch of embassies being attacked, four of them in the days before. You've right. got an event. First, they said 5 hours. Now they say seven or eight. The point is, it's over 5 hours.
Right.
This is going on, and then they're saying it's a protest. Break down, because you've worked in these levels. You've seen right. these drone feeds. What happens once this report comes in?
Well, first off, you can tell by the drone feed, Alex, it's not a freaking protest. I mean, people with protests show up, they gather around, they throw things. They're a big bunch. This was not a big bunch of people standing around in the street. These were armed fighters trying to breach the security of the compound. Again, it's a very different thing. Yes, granted, in Egypt next door, there was a breaching of the compound, but there was a very clear gathering of individuals with grievances. And let me be very clear here. It's very rare for a group of rioters to gather in hours of darkness. It kind of prevents the whole idea of seeing the protest. So that was right off the bat peculiar. And yeah, these feeds are being seen globally. Everybody who has a top secret SCI feed, this is the highest level of system, well, can dial into this. And when an attack is ongoing, Alex, everybody tunes in. In this case, a DOD drone was loaned to CIA, put under CIA control. And from that point on, I estimate probably about 10 o'clock, everything was being seen in real time. So everybody here, and keep in mind that 10 o'clock there is about sometime in the about 8 hours later here. So we're talking about essentially all of this happening during the beginning of and throughout the process of a business day.
So it's 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon. Right. Obviously, everybody at the Pentagon, you name it, their eyes on right. the ambassador being attacked.
Right. So there's no doubt. Everybody is standing, too, because they're at their workstations. There's no calling people in from a slumber. So during this time, then everybody's notified. And then what's supposed to happen is you bring the people together who have already planned contingencies. And Alex, let me be very clear for your audience here. Well, I don't know why I have to say this, but people seem to forget. This was a 9/11 anniversary. You should have had every resource in the region standing to ready to go. That includes special operations folks. That includes aircraft of all flavor that we have, logistical, fighters, anything else that may be called upon. And of course, break. There was already riots going on in other places. So how could you not miss the clues, clue after clue after clue, that something may happen, therefore you must be ready. So what logically should have happened is that you use those ready resources and begin planning. You try to figure out, what do I have available to me to react to this situation? And this is where it all gets very murky. And my sources do tell me that President Obama was called in. He is admitted that he got briefed on it. Further, my guys have told me he was called in and watched the video for a while, even. And during this time, supposedly, this group of national security experts includes Tom Donilon, his national security advisor, John Brennan, the terrorism advisor, and Deputy National Security Advisor Dennis McDonough, all gathered and supposedly put their brains together and started determining what they should do. And it just so happened that Leon Panetta was there, apparently, from meeting on some other things. So everybody was there. The whole brain trust was there. The question now becomes, Alex, what did they do or not do? And this, again, is the mystery, because this was a curtailed time period that's measurable. This was something that happened over hours. This was not something that happened in 10 minutes and you were done. You actually had major decision points all throughout the evening that related to things going on the ground.
And you've got right across the Mediterranean, 20 minutes away, you've got jets, you've got special forces all over the area, obviously even in country.
Right.
And clearly from your sources, I mean, expand on this, we're talking about a presidential stand down over at least 5 hours.
This is where it gets murky, because the president says he issued an order saying go do what's necessary to protect our people and protect our territory. So Bing West, God bless him, has done an editorial, and I support Bing on this, calling for the president to cough up the order. I think it's very simple. If he said he ordered it, then cough up the order.
But if he would have ordered it, you would have had drones, C-130s with Gatling guns and howitzers. I mean, they would have been there in, what, 20, 30 minutes?
It's a bit longer than that. We're talking about 450 miles for some of these places, so we're talking about still a very short amount of time. I mean, these things can move within an hour about 400 miles. So it's not significant that 400 miles would have slowed these people down that much. And frankly, helicopters, some special operations helicopters can chew up that space pretty quick. They can get mid-air refuel. So there's any number of options. I did an editorial on this, just so your audience can actually kind of measure this and compare it. I did an editorial on FoxNews.com. It talks about what President Reagan did when he was confronted with the fact that students on the island of Grenada in 1983 may become captured. So in that editorial, I don't want to waste our time here, but I walk through how President Reagan did his decision making and what confined time spaces they had there. And once you read that, you recognize that if Reagan can do it in 83 in 6 hours to invade a country, surely we could have done a lot more within the space of time we had with this. So
you've got an island thousands of miles away, and he could do it very quickly. So expanding, What's the bottom line with Obama and all of his surrogates the next day saying these were protesters? We know that's a lie.
Right.
We know that this was an arms cache facility. We know there were Turkey that you alluded to. Break that down with arms shipments to the Wahhabists and others that are attacking Assad. So Colonel, break all this down for us, what we're really dealing with here.
Well, my theory is, based on the information I have, and again, we're hoping more people will break ranks and say more, is some of your audience may remember something called Camp Chapman. Camp Chapman was a CIA operation back in 2009, December 2009, that went very bad. Basically, Al-Qaeda ate our lunch. This was a Jordanian doctor who they thought had been doubled. They thought he was working for us. He was still working for Al-Qaeda. And he conveniently came in with a body bomb and killed, according to CIA, their best bin Laden analysts. So I think what we're looking at here, Alex, is something similar. I do believe Ansar al-Sharia got wind of what we were doing there in the compound, in the consulate, and frankly, they were able to penetrate to the level of where they were effective in going in and attacking our folks. And let me be very clear what this means to me and what I think is going on. There was about 20,000 surface-to-air missiles, SA-7, SA-22s, according to my CIA sources, on the ground in Libya after we so-called liberated the Libyan people. Well, only about 5,000 of those have been recovered. Some of those, I believe, have shown up in Syria with the rebels. So with that said, your appearance here, and this is where I think certain Democrats have already kind of alluded to the fact there's something deeper here they don't want to get into. It's all about essentially a Fast and Furious gone wrong in the Middle East. I think what they were doing here was a buyback program, trying to get these weapons out of the hands of folks in Libya, and then trying to give them to the Turks, who then were going to pass them over to the Syrians. And so I think what we see here is a Middle Eastern version of Fast and Furious. And I think what we have to sort through here, which is going to be the difficult piece, is who within the administration knew that, who maybe didn't like the way things were playing out. Maybe Ambassador Stephen found out things he didn't like about what was going on. I know theoretically my friends at CIA have told me he was not aware fully of the details of the covert action relating to this buyback or movement of arms. And the question becomes, who did what and why did they do it within the context of that time frame? Now, the next morning, clearly, there was zero evidence, no credible intelligence that there was ever a protest. Therefore, someone had to come up with a cover story or concoct a story which out of whole cloth. And it's been very interesting listening to President Obama speak about this, because according to him, within his Rose Garden comments, he said it was terrorism. Yet in a 60 Minutes interview he did just minutes later after that, he says now, and this was released yesterday by 60 Minutes, CBS, saying, well, we don't know if it's a terrorist act. And then, of course, he's come back and again said, of course, I thought it was a terrorist act. There's been back and forth. So this, to me, should send up all sorts of flares to the mainstream media to start asking really hard questions. Why on earth would you lie? And let me be very clear about this. Why on earth would you lie about a video being the reason for a full-on al-Qaeda attack on an ambassador and one of your key overseas missions where you've actually invested a great time of sweat equity trying to free a people. Why would you not tell the truth about what happened? And the whole premise of this video being the reason for this is taken on a whole insane life of its own. And so the next day, the very next day after this, you know, it's the 12th of September of this year, someone had to come up with an idea of what they were going to say. They've attributed this to Alex, a talking points memo put together by one each Lieutenant General retired Jim Clapper, who's the DNI, Director of National Intelligence. And supposedly, Clapper gave this memo with the full blessing of the Director of CIA, General Petraeus, to members of the president's team. And it was from this point that everybody went out to brief the Congress, the media, and the American people. Well, it's adequately, I think, been proven to me that whatever was in that memo was a lie. So one of the things we should do is demand a copy of the memo. Just put it out there. Much like the vaunted authorization document the president should have put together to authorize military force. And let me be very clear on this. Only the president can authorize, in times of extremis, the crossing of international borders without other countries approving it. He had to personally approve that. So the same thing here. Someone had to personally, at a very high level, approve this talking points memo, which outlined the quote-unquote video theory of the reason for the attack. So there's two key pieces of paper here, Alex. I would estimate probably should be no more than one page each that are really key and critical to resolving the responsibility, both the moments of the attack as well as the outcome of somehow blaming, coming up with the conclusion that the video was to blame for
sure,
the whole attack.
Sure, it's a way to blame the First Amendment, and they can have the mullahs come out and call for restricting our free speech. Condensing this down for laymen out there,
sure,
and going over this, and what we talked about right before we went on air, I mean, I said to you, I said, Colonel, you know, this looks like arms to Syria. We know that's going on. We know right. They buy, you know, nukes back from the Russians, you know, buyback.
Right.
But that's giving it from one al-Qaeda or radical Wahhabist jihadi group to another. I mean, that's where they're going. It's that conduit out of Libya into Syria. No fan of Assad, but my God, this is putting even worse people in. So we got this whole proxy war going on. And I said, from my sources, both media but also in government, one in and around the Pentagon, that, and I heard this weeks ago and didn't go on air with it just because it would have sounded too wild at that time, that basically this was a hit on Stevens because he had gotten cold feet and was getting upset about stockpiling all these you know, different types of missiles there at the facility. What is your bottom line on that and what you said to me off air, and sure, and what it says about the White House that they would have the Nixon moment? If they got away with Fast and Furious, even if Obama gets reelected tomorrow, there's no way they're getting away with this, because now the SEAL families are coming out, can't kill them. Obama's been caught lying. We know there's the video feed now. I mean, we know it went on for way more than 5 hours. We know the stand down took place. So repeat to me, if you can, what you said and then what this signifies in the larger policy.
Right. Well, let me just echo, I agree with you. There's a British article today, I don't know if you saw, the British are now saying some of the weapons that they left behind, they stored with us, are now missing too. So it's very clear, whatever was stored in those facilities are gone. So I think that's a big point. Right here, Alex, I think it's where there's one of two things. And this is why I opened our interview with pointing out that during that entire period, the White House wasn't seeming to be all that concerned about the presence of where is Ambassador Stevens? Now, think about that. He is a sitting ambassador potentially going missing right before a major election. The last thing you want is him captured. So how is it that that's not the first thing on your mind, is his recovery?
It could be the Iranian hostage crisis all over again.
Right. Right. So how is it that the president wasn't the first thing out of his mouth when he was asked about this? Well, our first priority was recovery of Ambassador Stevens because we wanted to prevent a hostage crisis. How do
Obama would have looked great if he sent in helicopters first, bombed with jets, and then helicopters to kill al-Qaeda. That would have been his reelection right there.
I think showing strength would have been a great indicator of resolve. And that's where it all kind of breaks down. So I don't know What happened to Ambassador Stevens? There are some theories out there that relating to him, and one of those is that maybe he got set up. Now, I will say this. To me, this does have the hallmarks of a setup. I don't know how to say that other than CIA got set up by Al-Qaeda in 2009. They thought they were dealing with so-called friendly elements of Al-Qaeda. And Alex, I think part of the deal here is certain people within our government thought they could make friends with Al-Qaeda. They thought that Al-Qaeda, for purposes of Syria, may be an adequate partner, if you will, to do some of the dirty work. And I think that's part of the real thing that they're worried about coming out here.
And now Al-Qaeda has got, undoubtedly, as you said, over 10,000 missiles. They can hold the entire West hostage.
Right. And I think that's the huge issue here. And this is something, Alex, let me remind your audience that this was talked about 18 months ago when we first started down this path.
When you were on my show, you said they're going to get all the high-tech weapons from Gaddafi.
Right. And this was one of the concerns we talked about. I talked about with you. I talked about with the mainstream media that we had to be careful how we destabilized. As much as Gaddafi was bad, the outcome of basically Balkanization of Libya would be far worse. And that's where we're at. So I think there's multiple reasons here. The White House really didn't want to talk about this going wrong. And I think in many ways, no matter what's going to come out, and I think there's going to be a lot more coming out, no matter how you cut it. They did not want to have a major discussion of things going wrong and what they showed up to be one of their major foreign policy victories. And I think it's very clear here that predicted this would happen.
Sure. So here it is. Either they hung him out to dry because they didn't want to go and kill their own Al-Qaeda people, which they've now admitted had been hired as the security for them.
Right.
They don't want to show that they're working with Al-Qaeda. Or B, it's worse. The ambassador wasn't going to play ball, so he had to be gotten rid of. Or, again, their own Al-Qaeda people double-crossed him, maybe even got the money probably, and then double-snatched the missiles again.
I think that your last option is there may be more to it, but I think that's the most realistic option at this point. It's very clear that Al-Qaeda got through the wire. Through the wire. They got the stuff back. It's gone. And we were arming and paying people to so-called friends that we weren't vetting. And let me be very clear. This is one of the things I've said on Fox News. I said this within 24 hours of the event. I'm told by my sources that we weren't doing those hard things we're supposed to be doing as intelligence officers to verify and vet, to vet someone to make sure they're actually working for you. We didn't do those hard things. We didn't look at where they lived. We didn't look at what they were doing. We didn't work to verify who they said they were and the fact that they were loyal to us. And by the fact that these, and part of it was, Alex, the officers were told, don't worry about it. Don't do those things because we want to be friendly with them. And this is all about trying to show a new face of the United States and be all friendly and not do those traditional things, which I would have done as an intelligence officer to make sure that the guy sitting across from me actually is going to do what I asked him to do.
Well,
and he won't come back.
That's why you're so uniquely perfect to be able to break this down. Talk about your book. Talk about the website, because for many years you actually did these type of things. You could have killed bin Laden. That's now been declassified years after you were first telling Congress about it. And so it just continues where the system needs Al-Qaeda. And then I want to ask you this. Where do you predict it's all going? Because you've had amazing, over the horizon predictions, knowing Al-Qaeda, knowing the Wahhabists, knowing all these angles, how the intelligence community uses them and then they turn against them, this blowback thing. Where is it going to go putting them in charge of Libya and Syria down the road?
Well, not good. I think you're inherently giving folks who want to destabilize order the ability to create chaos. And I don't think it's in our interest. I think we need to take Syria, and as bad as the Syrian regime is, you want to get rid of the Syrian regime, but you don't want to get rid of the Syrian government. The government is what holds that country together. Trust me, if we do to Syria what we did to Libya, it'll be far worse. With that said, taking a step back to Operation Darkheart, my book, it's notable that it's in the book. We actually brought a warlord in. We vetted him. We did all the things necessary to make sure he was working for us. And oh, by the way, Alex, he didn't blow us up. I'm sorry. I don't mean to joke about it, but it's very clear there's things you can do to do this sort of thing successfully in that environment. They're not easy. It takes time. You've got to be doubly sure because the obvious consequence is the death of you or the people you're trying to support.
How do you vet them?
Well, I don't want to get into it because it's classified. But I can say there's a regimen of things you need to go through. There's ways of checking on people. There's ways of testing them. Basically, it's much like you would do a snitch on a police department. You want to figure out ways to make sure that they're telling you the right gouge about whatever you're dealing with. There's ways of doing it, trust me. But if you take a shortcut and don't do those things, then you are doubling down on your own disaster. And I think that's what we've seen here time and time again. And I was told by my guys, my contacts, we weren't doing those hard things. We weren't doing the vetting to the level necessary to protect our own folks. So Operation Dark Art's a good read. You can go through as much as DOD will let me talk about it. By the way, we had a First Amendment victory on that, Alex. This is the first time we're talking about this anywhere. The Department of Defense lost in court. They tried to dismiss my First Amendment suit over standing. They said I didn't have standing to bring suit because I didn't follow proper procedure. Well, we won. The court said I have standing, and now we can proceed with our First Amendment suit against DOD for violation of my First Amendments. That's coming soon.
Wow, so that's breaking news there. I just noticed on your site something new. What's the private war there on the site?
One of the things your readers can go to my site, OperationDarkHeart.com. Peter Lance, investigative journalist, did a detailed investigation of the book, and he basically put everything back in his article, what they took out of the book. Peter's a brilliant writer. You probably had him on for Triple Cross.
Yes.
And he did a brilliant job of researching. I don't know how he found out some of the information, but everything the Pentagon wanted out of the book, he put back in the article, The Private War of Anthony Schaefer. Your readers can read it, and the listeners can read it. And it talks about, like you mentioned, some of the things we could and should have done to Al-Qaeda and some of these other guys before 9/11.
Okay, in closing here, and we appreciate your time, Colonel Schaefer. Looking at this, there's got to be a method to what the State Department and the Obama people are doing. But you put the Muslim Brotherhood in. You put Al-Qaeda. That's the main group now in Libya. Right. Al-Qaeda, they even admit now, is the main core force. Some estimates are as much as half. The CFR a couple months ago said, quote, we need Al-Qaeda. But then I'm told I've got to give my rights up, have the TSA, you know, molest my family, grab on me. I've got to see checkpoints on the highway because of Al-Qaeda. But then I get the internal government training manuals. It's all about gun owners, returning veterans. You know, we're the threat. Clearly, they're using the Al-Qaeda threat to set up a police state, power grab here domestically, you know, mission creep. And then overseas, how does government think it's going to get away with putting Al-Qaeda in charge of all these countries? I mean, the blowback from this, I mean, people aren't stupid now. And it's not like stuff happens in the 80s and then 20 years later something happens. We're talking about in the same year we're having blowback. Right. And obviously it's going to get a lot worse. So how does what's happening in the power structure? Because from my view, we've never had a perfect power structure, but they're getting so sloppy, so reckless, so delusional.
Well, two things I'll say. First, we've got to get the NDAA done. I mean, the idea that President Obama, or any president really, can assassinate U.S. citizens or indefinitely detain anybody because they're a threat, because he says so. Are you kidding me? We've got to fix that. And this goes back to the larger issue, which you're pointing out. We have to look at threat for what it really is. And everything we do, Alex, has to be based on the real threat. We have to do a survey, figure out globally a strategy that's based on threat. So much of what we're seeing right now is whimsy. And let me be very clear for your audience here. The TSA isn't making anybody safe. It's great theater, but it ain't making you any safer when they go through these things. I've been through several times, and I'm fascinated every time of how they either miss things, or, you know, one time I was wearing a shirt and somehow they were convinced my breasts were somehow missiles or something. I mean, that was literally insane, because they had to do, after I did one of these body searches, they had to go back and physically touch me. Are you kidding me? So there's real problems here with both the domestic policy of what they're doing to quote unquote make us safe, and the larger threat, which is developing overseas. There is a disconnect. We don't have a government with a clear policy and vision of what we need to worry about. You have disconnected elements which are functioning, in my judgment, very partisan way, based on politics rather than.
I was about to say, you've got all these agencies power grabbing, and right. Why shouldn't DHS get a bunch of toilet attendants, throw them in uniforms, and declare the entire Bill of Rights is gone, and they're now little commandos? I mean, this is classical tyranny.
And that's what we have to be aware of. We need to look at what the real threats are, both globally and domestically, and then base our strategy for dealing with it, and then fund the strategy. Right now, we're doing it completely backwards. We're funding whatever anybody wants, and this is partly Congress's job. I fought Congress big time, and I'm trying to work with certain members of Congress, like Representative Walter Jones and others, who really are looking at how we need to force the federal government take a big step back, look at real threats, and not simply fund things for funding's sake, and try to establish a strategy, both domestically and globally, that reflects what the real threats are rather than what they're doing right now.
What do you make of the 10,000-plus missing missiles? I mean, describe some of these missiles, because I'm told there's some heat-seeking, radar-guided, unguided. I mean, anybody now with these, not just in the U.S., if they can get them here, but in Europe and other areas, I mean, they can shoot down airliners. Now we're talking about real terrorism, and then I'm going to be told I've got to give up more rights because our government let al-Qaeda into Libya? I mean, I guess that's part of the plan. They think that we're so dumb, they can create all this chaos and then use it to take our freedoms.
Well, this is what baffles me, because as you point out, Alex, we talked about this 18 months ago on the inevitable downside of allowing Libya to fail. I mean, this is where it doesn't make sense to me unless, you know, there's something else going on here that I don't know. With that said, the surface-to-air missiles we're talking about, the SA-7s and SA-22s, essentially are shoulder-launched missiles. They're, most of them that I'm aware of are essentially optical. They actually are heat-seeking. They track heat. And so when you fire it off, it actually goes to a heat source and tries to blow up in or near it. And what we're seeing right now is obviously most civilian aircraft do not have any countermeasures. These things can be defeated. That's why when you see our fighters doing a run low to the ground, they pull up and you see all these flares popping off. Well, those flares are designed for the heat seekers to track the flares, not the aircraft. So this is why you see that. Civilian airliners don't have that option. So obviously this is a huge threat more to civilian aviation than to military aviation. Military aviation, much more difficult to actually get one of these things in close.
Sure, somebody just sits at the end of the airport, a plane takes off, and it's like shooting fish in a barrel.
Right, exactly. And so this is why it's so insidious and so real. And so we have to be aware of where these weapons are going and where they're going to go. I never was a proponent, as you know, for boots on the ground. But I did say once we, you know, destabilized and allowed the Libyan government to fail.
You said once you do it, you own it.
Once you break it, you got to fix it. And we broke it big time. And what I'm worried about, Alex, and I think you and your audience is that if something goes wrong, these weapons, these surface-to-air missiles get out of Libya, they can go to Europe or they can come here. But no matter how you cut it, we don't have civilian airliners, commercial airliners, adequately prepared to be able to jink and jag and fire off flares to avoid these things. And it's inevitably going to result in a loss of life.
Well, look, you throw out Gaddafi, who's working with the West for 7 years. You put the worst miscreants of the Middle East in charge. When airliners get shot down, I think it's safe to say with 15,000 of these missiles missing or whatever, there's going to be some problems. I hope the Secretary General of NATO and Obama and all these other people, Sarkozy, well, he's already facing jail. I hope they all get thrown in jail because they are the ones that put the gun in al-Qaeda's hand. Can you close on that? Any other points, Colonel, that you haven't been able to add here?
Well, no, I think this is one of those things. And let me point out to your audience, I was actually a whistleblower against the Bush White House. So I'd like to believe that your audience understands I'm all about accountability. I think this is all about trying to protect the American people, no matter who's in charge. And frankly, I think, have done some things with international leaders, Sarkozy and others, which were not in our best interest. And frankly, not in the best interest of the Libyan people. The Libyan people are the ones now suffering through this. And I don't believe the leveling of Misrata really helped anybody. And frankly, you know, we made some huge mistakes. So now we have to account for those mistakes and own up to them. Just say mistakes were made and let's fix them. Otherwise, if we don't fix them, we don't track down those weapons of, the surface-to-air missiles and other things, we, in some way, will pay the price for that.
Well, I mean, isn't it a criminal act to go call it a peace mission and bomb Libya for 6 months or whatever it was and then put al-Qaeda in?
I still believe that whole incursion, the so-called quick kinetic strike, was illegal. It was not constitutional. Everybody I've talked to on the Hill, and I'm very good friends with Bruce Fine, a constitutional lawyer. He has been very clear on this. There was no constitutional basis. There was no appropriation of money. There was no legal mm-hmm. determination for them to do it. So it was a completely illegal act. And I wish people would recognize
sure.
that this was a complete bypass of the Constitution.
Colonel Shaver, thank you so much for the time. I've got to throw one more in here because I know you look at this all the time. You talk to constitutional experts like Bruce Fein, who's also a friend of this show. Looking at all this, looking at what Obama says he's going to do versus Romney, I know that you're nonpartisan and just try to have accountability and defend the republic. What is your gut on what Obama will do if he gets back in briefly versus Romney? Because Obama, as you know, has said NATO is who they go to for military action, the New World Army. They don't go to Congress. And Congress, other than Congressman Jones that you mentioned earlier, introducing bills to impeach, if that continues, nothing's being done. So, I mean, we're really moving down that road towards global governance.
Well, that's what really is bothersome. And again, the folks I work with, both on the Hill and, you know, with Bruce Fein and company, recognize the slippery slope of where we're going with this. Let's just use Libya as a metaphor. Libya, any military action should have been approved by Congress. Article 5 of the Constitution, I think, is very very clear on this. I think it's Article 5. I don't know my constitutional laws, I should. But we should be actually stipulating what we can and cannot do based on Congress. Only Congress can declare war. And to me, any extension of military action beyond response, emergency response to being attacked, should fall to Congress. And this is something every American should recognize. There's a reason why the founders wrote it this way, so it would not be easy for the executive to run off and engage in war. And let's remember, George Washington, our founding father, recognized the folly of this and actually supported the idea of having restraint. He personally could have been king. Think about that, Alex. He could have been king, yet he said, no, we've got to find a way to sustain our government in such a way there's checks and balances. And right now, the checks and balances are completely out of whack. This is something I've been working with my, you know, with Congress on. They've got to reestablish themselves as something more than the invertebrate branch, as Bruce Fein always calls them.
Colonel Shaver, thank you so much for the time. Undoubtedly, this is going to be very, very interesting road ahead. And I just appreciate you having the courage to go on television, not just here, but on Fox News and other places, and tell the truth. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Alex.
Amazing. All right, folks. We're going to go ahead and pull up the section of the Constitution itself here. And that is Article 1, Section 8, Powers of the Congress. And it goes over that they have the power of the purse, the power of tribunals, to declare war. So there it is in Article 1, Section 8. To declare war, grant letters of marque and reprisal, and make rules concerning captures on land and water, to raise and support armies, but no appropriation of money to that use shall be for longer term than 2 years. To provide and maintain a navy. To make rules for the government, regulation of the land and naval forces, to provide for calling forth of the militia, to execute the laws of the Union, suppress insurrections, and repel invasions, the provision of organizing, arming, and disciplining of the militia. It just goes on and on. So there you go, Article 1, Section 8. And Article 1, Section 9, I know, says the president will not serve as an officer in any foreign government or system, as Obama did under Article 1, Section 9, becoming the head of the UN Security Council for a while. They are just breaking the Bill of Rights and Constitution in front of everyone on purpose. Powerful interview with Shaver. You know, on Fox News, it was 3 minutes boiled down. Off air, he said, yeah, this has all the hallmarks of a hit. I forgot to get to this one point. So let's document, Cam, this. I knew I was forgetting to ask him about something. This is being reported by the Washington Times. Is a general losing his job over Benghazi? A general that tried to refuse to not stand down? That's in the Washington Times. An AFRICOM general, Carter Ham, unconfirmed reports ask, was Ham relieved of command minutes before ordering Benghazi rescue? And he needs to speak out. He needs to talk about that. Why did they want that guy to go bye-bye? This is a big deal. This is a very, very big deal. So that backs up basically what Colonel Shaver was talking about there. Back tomorrow, I'm going to be on the radio, 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. And then we're going to be back from 5 to midnight or even later with our big team of reporters and the great crew behind the scenes, like Marcos Morales in there tirelessly running the boards, and Wes in there, and of course, Rob Doom. We're going to have Jakari Jackson and David Knight in here. I'll be in the radio studio, Studio 1. They'll be in Studio 2. Going back and forth with reports, we've got a full list. If you go to Infowars.com, you'll see we've got a big puppet theater there with Obama and Romney. And we have a link there to the free video feed. You won't just have to be a subscriber tomorrow to see the video production that we're going to have. And we've got a huge list of some of the most informative guests there on the site, like Max Kaiser, Gerald Celente, Webster Tarpley, Dr. Paul Craig Roberts. The list just goes on and on. So you definitely do not want to miss any of that information. Starting back live at 5 p.m. Central. Again, Gerald Celente, Max Kaiser, Wayne Madsen, Paul Craig Roberts, Lou Rockwell, Nomi Prinz, Webster Tarpley, and others. So make sure to tune in and to also tell your friends and family to tune in to the free video links and audio links at InfoWars.com, PrisonPlanet.tv, and PrisonPlanet.com. And in closing, the new glossy magazine, the November issue, is out. It deals with television, the dumbing down, the brainwashing, increases in seizures because of television, and the fact that people are being systematically programmed. You can buy them in groups of 10 up to 100 at cost. They're basically like little color 60-page books with a big color poster on the inside. Or you can get a subscription for yourself and then hand it off to friends and family, or get a gift subscription. And that's 12 of these. When we have back issues, we'll also add those in. So sometimes it'll be more. But 12 issues guaranteed, delivered to the police station's door, the library's door, your church's door, your dad's door, your mom's door, your son's door, your wife's door, your boss's door. You want to educate people. 12 of these, $59.95, half of that's the shipping cost. Shipping is included. Get a yearly subscription right now and support the true alternative media. Great new weapon, InfoWarsStore.com, to subscribe or to buy them in bulk and hand them out to the zombies that are out there. And again, great job to the crew. I want to thank everybody for the job they did. It was good to have Aaron doing the news as well tonight. And I will see you back tomorrow for Marathon Broadcast. Let me see, I'll be 3 hours on the radio. That'll be a video feed as well. Again, you can send that link out to friends and family. And then back from 5 to midnight, that's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's 10 hours at least. We're going to have reporters on the ground, special guests, so much more. That's it for this edition of Teleprompter Free, InfoWars Nightly News. Lord willing, we'll see you back tomorrow. Thanks for all your support.